Welcome to the lecture on pre-malignant lesions and conditions. In this chapter and lecture series, you will be able to understand what is pre-malignancy. The new terminology now is potentially malignant lesions. What are the changes seen in the tissue? The clinical lesions that are involved and special importance to leukoplakia, erythroplakia, palatal changes associated with reverse smoking, oral submucous fibrosis, and of course we'll be talking about the histology and the differential diagnosis. When it comes to the lesion per se, we have the normal mucosa, which because of the influence of factors like chemicals, radiation, virus, etc., leads to damage of the DNA. This damaged DNA is checked by the host P53 molecules and repair may ensue. But repeated effects of the chemical radiation or the virus shifts the whole phenomenon towards an irreversible change. Although pre-malignancy still shows some change which is repairable, but the point of no return leads to development of carcinoma. We are mainly talking about the epithelial changes in this particular lecture series. There were certain discussions that were held, as in the words pre-neoplastic, pre-malignant, pre-cancer conveyed the meaning that all the disorders were unequivocally associated with future development of oral squamous cell carcinoma. But literature shows that there were carcinomas that are developing without the presence of pre-existing pre-malignant lesions. Also, there were long-standing pre-malignant lesions and conditions which did not convert to carcinoma. Hence, the term potentially malignant was preferred, which conveys the meaning that some disorders may have increased potential for oral squamous cell carcinoma. This has been put forth by Varnakulasurya and colleagues in 2007 and has been published in Journal of Oral Pathology and Medicine. The term potentially malignant disorders was recommended to refer to pre-cancer, as it conveys that not all the disorders described under this term may transform into cancer. Hence, the new term given is potentially malignant disorders. So, what were the earlier terms? The earlier terms used were pre-malignant lesion, which was defined as a morphologically altered tissue in which cancer is more likely to occur than its apparently normal counterpart, given by WHO in the year 1978. Leukoplakia, erythroplakia, and palatal changes associated with reverse smoking fall under the ambit of pre-malignant lesion. Pre-malignant condition, on the other hand, is a generalized state. This generalized state is associated with the person developing cancer. So, a generalized state of the body associated with increased risk of cancer. Examples would be sideropenic dysphagia, submucous fibrosis, and erosive form of lichen planus. What is common with all these potentially malignant lesions? They are all reversible. If you indicate that the patient should stop the habit, it is reversible. And all of these can have a tendency to convert if the habit continues to a point of no return, leading to malignant transformation. This is how the normal mucosa will look like. So you can see that it is uniformly, homogeneously pink, skin colored, and shows no keratinization. The buccal mucosa should be non-keratinized. The vermilion zone. Sometimes the occlusal level, you can see some white discoloration that is mainly due to frictional keratosis, which is a normal feature. Histologically, you will see a basement membrane with tall columnar cells residing as the stratum basale, with the superficial cells showing stratum spinosum and stratum granulosum and stratum corneum if it is a keratinized tissue. What happens in dysplasia? Dysplasia is the term used for a tissue, here the epithelial tissue, when it becomes disorganized, giving rise to a chaotic appearance. As in this case, you can see that the basal cells are no longer palisaded, the structural arrangement is no longer evident, the loss of architecture We call this epithelium as a dysplastic epithelium. When you talk about an individual cell, we call a cell as normal and atypical cell. When you talk about tissue, you call it as normal architecture and a dysplastic architecture. What are the factors that cause this particular change? Various carcinogens are predominantly tobacco induced. They may be a smoking form or a smokeless form. Of course, they are accentuated by alcohol. There are malignancy causing viruses, chemicals, radiation, nutritional deficiencies, as well as some genetic disorders wherein the oncogenes and the tumor suppressor genes are affected. But this is not all. There is a multifactorial reason for development of malignancy. Genetic, epigenetic, with surface alteration of molecules and intercellular interactions all play a role in causing malignant transformation. When you look at a normal tissue, it can show some genetic change which may not be understood or identified morphologically. This is the first stage of transformation. When histologically you see evidence in the epithelium, that is type 2 leading to dysplasia. When there is a clinical change leading to a white plaque, it is called leukoplakia. When there is atrophy, leads to erythroplakia because the thickness of the epithelium is lost and there is thinning leading to red color. It is type 4. This can be generally seen in most of the epithelial transformations. Most of these potentially malignant lesions are white in color. This may be attributed to a few reasons. The first three reasons are because of increase in thickness of the epithelium. The epithelium as a whole may be thickened, or there may be thickness of the spinous layer, which is called as acanthosis, or there may be increased keratinization. When there is pathological increase in the keratinization, we call it as para or orthokeratosis, ending with an SES. Fungal infections like candidosis can also be the reason for white color of the lesion. Fibrosis of the connective tissue leads to less visibility of the underlying vascularity, leading to white lesion. Also, blockage of the lymphatic drainage can also lead to accumulation of fluid, leading to white discoloration. So let's see the first lesion, leukoplakia. A few moments back, you saw the normal mucosa. Here in this lesional tissue, you can make out that there is a white plaque or patch here with a characteristic cracked mud appearance. In Greek, leuko means white and plakia represents the word patch. Axel T. in 1996 defined leukoplakia as a predominantly white lesion of the oral mucosa that cannot be characterized as any other definable lesion. Oral leukoplakia will transform into cancer. As the definition suggests, it is a diagnosis of exclusion. If you are not able to diagnose this as any other lesion, then we can diagnose it as leukoplakia. The most common etiological agent is tobacco, in either smoking form or a chewing form. The chemicals, predominantly nitrosamines, which are released by tobacco, irritates the mucosa constantly, leading to epithelial changes in the form of dysplasia. The fact that remains important is discontinuation of the habit will definitely cause reversal of this particular lesion. The other important causes could be candidal infection. Candida albicans is an opportunistic infection. The local area where the tobacco, smoking, or chewing forms are in contact with the mucosa, it gets immunologically compromised. This leads to the accumulation of the Candida albicans hyphae. Candida themselves are capable of producing nitrosamines, which can cause carcinogenic change. Vitamin A, vitamin B, and iron deficiency are also indicated in leukoplakia. Vitamin A is an important parameter for maturation of the epithelium. Vitamin B is important for vascularity and hemoglobin levels. Deficiency of these will cause improper maturation of the epithelium, which hastens the progress of leukoplakia. Human papilloma virus and herpes group of viruses, they are known to cause epithelial changes and are indicated in leukoplakia. Dissimilar restorations, which have been kept in the oral cavity, leads to galvanic currents that are passing through, and these galvanic currents, which change the texture of the oral mucosa, can also be an etiological factor in leukoplakia. Chronic irritation due to dentures, malocclusion, hot spicy food, sharp teeth are also indicated in causative agent as leukoplakia. Alcohol is predominantly an accentuator. The chemicals produced by tobacco are easily dissolved and penetrate much deeper in cases of people who take alcohol. Syphilis earlier was considered to be an indicator of leukoplakia. Following the advent of antibiotics like penicillin, it has substantially reduced the incidence of leukoplakia in syphilitic individuals. Coming on to the clinical features, if a person has been smoking from the year of 20, it takes roughly 10 years for the chemicals to act, and the most common incidence of leukoplakia is seen in the third decade. In the Indian subcontinent, males have a slightly higher predilection than females, and the most common site is the site where chewing forms of tobacco are placed, the buccal mucosa, followed by floor of the mouth, gingiva. Of course, cigarette, BD or pipe smoking has a higher incidence of lip cancers. Let's have a look at some of the pictures. The predominantly wrinkled appearance seen in this particular picture is the pre-leukoplakia. Sometimes the pre-leukoplakia may progress to form a cracked mud appearance as seen in this commissure. This white lesion at the level of the occlusal plane would be a frictional keratosis. So generally, leukoplakia is seen as an asymptomatic white patch. Larger lesions can give rise to a cracked mud appearance. In the floor of the mouth, typically you see an ebbing tide pattern of keratinization. Extensive white plaques, which are homogeneous as seen in this buccal mucosa, are another feature of leukoplakia. Homogeneous leukoplakia may also be seen in the floor of the mouth. These are all predominantly white lesions, but leukoplakia does occur with some erosive areas. A homogeneous leukoplakia as such can transform to some areas showing redness. In this lesion of the lip, you can see white patch associated with some reddish areas. Here we can see a non-homogeneous leukoplakia with areas of ulceration and erosion. These areas of ulceration and erosion are the sites of biopsy that you should consider, as these will be the areas where malignant transformation could have started. Non-homogeneous leukoplakia at the commissure of the lip here. And this type of leukoplakia, which shows predominantly reddish base with white spots, is called as the speckled leukoplakia. Benoxi has classified leukoplakia as leukoplakia simplex, leukoplakia erosiva, and leukoplakia verrucosa. Leukoplakia verrucosa was termed as the one having the maximum malignant transformation rate. Mehta and colleagues classified leukoplakia as homogeneous, ulcerative, or nodular or speckled leukoplakia. Overall, leukoplakia can be classified as homogeneous or non-homogeneous. Let's look at the histological features. The very first feature that is seen is the increase in the keratinization. As you can see here, the keratin layers are multilayered. Apart from that, you can have increase in the thickness of the spinosum layer. This increase in the spinosum layer is called as acanthosis. This acanthosis is associated with hyperkeratinization in this particular field. Whatever be it, the basement membrane that separates the epithelium and the connective tissue is intact in a leukoplakia. Here is a picture of the basement membrane of a normal mucosa. This picture is of a dysplastic mucosa, and you can still see intact basement membrane. Basilar hyperplasia. This leads to distension of the basement membrane in the lower third of the rete ridge. Characteristically described as drop-shaped rete ridges. The basal cells are typically hyperchromatic, showing increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. So the second important feature would be loss of basal cell polarity. The cells are generally located perpendicular to the basement membrane. In case of dysplasia, the basement membrane's orientation of the basal cells are lost. They are no longer perpendicular but are haphazard. This is called as loss of polarity. Here you can see further another histological field showing loss of basal cell polarity. The polarity here does not mean the location of the nucleus. It means the orientation of the cell is lost. They are no longer perpendicular to the basement membrane. The individual cells, they show bizarre shapes and show hyperchromatism. This is normal. If you compare, you can see different shapes and sizes of cells with different intensities of nuclear chromatin condensation. These are the pleomorphism and hyperchromatism. Here we can see an anaphase, probably a telophase, as there is constriction. Here you can see some mitotic figures. There is increase in mitotic figure as well as presence of abnormal mitosis. In a particular field, the basal cells can show mitosis, maybe one or two. But in this field, you can see one metaphase, another metaphase, a telophase, and maybe another anaphase here. Example of a metaphase, example of an anaphase, and example of a telophase is shown in these figures. Normally, a cell should divide into two. In this case, the nuclear material is dividing into three units. It is a tripolar mitosis, considered to be an abnormal mitotic figure. The basal cells, followed by spinous cell, followed by the superficial cells, form the orientation or the stratification. This stratification is lost in dysplasia. When you look at the histology, you won't be able to make out which is basal cell, which is spinous cell. This is called as irregular stratification. The cells lose their desmosomal attachments and they separate out, causing lack of cohesion. This is the first instance where the cells behave on their own and begin to migrate. In higher power, you can appreciate that the cells have a very prominent nucleoli. Normally, the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is 1:4. In a spinous cell. In dysplasia, it can become enlarged to the size of 1:1. 1:1 is normally the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio of a basal cell. So if you see 1:1 ratio in a basal cell, you may probably even think it as normal. The keratinization should generally occur on the top layer. Here you can see within individual cells, you can see eosinophilic collagenized here. In each of these cells, you can see keratinization happening in individual cells. These are called as dyskeratosis. The dysplastic cells, which are highly active, they take their nutrition from the connective tissue. When the person does not stop the habit and he continues to smoke, or the viral or the radiation damage continues to ensue, there are increased nuclear demands for the basal cell hyperplasia, proliferation, migration, etc. The cells tend to go closer to the basement membrane to draw more nutrition. When they do this, they mutate to form collagenase. This collagenase destroys the basement membrane. And once the basement membrane is destroyed, it leads to invasion. That is the point of no return, leading to malignants. This is all about the clinical and histological features as well as the etiopathogenesis of leukoplakia. In the next lecture, we'll continue with the histology and talk about grading of dysplasia. We'll talk about the differential diagnosis of leukoplakia. We'll talk about the other two potentially malignant disorders, erythroplakia and palatal changes associated with reverse smoking. And as a differential diagnosis, we'll also talk about stomatitis nicotina. Thank you.